Hi, welcome to the show. I'm Marty Otañez, the host and producer of Getting High on Anthropology. Today we have Dan Banks with Next Generation IPM. I met you a couple weeks ago in Pueblo. There was a conference, cannabis research conference, pretty exciting. So why were you there and what was one of the most exciting things you took home from that conference?
You know, I went to the ICR conference really just hoping to get a better understanding of the breadth of different cannabis-related science-focused research going on and the different people working on different problems. And I think the thing that I took away the most is that it was really refreshing to be at a conference where the goal was really sharing knowledge, building knowledge, and kind of camaraderie within the whole cannabis space and not so industry-focused. It was really interesting to hear about the different medical advancements that have been going on and, you know, really inspiring to meet all of the various different people working in different aspects of cannabis.
So. Excellent. No, I was really glad to meet you and learn about your work. And so you're with a company, you're the founder of Next Generation. So what is Next Generation and why did you create the company?
Yeah, so it's Next Generation IPM, and the IPM stands for Integrated Pest Management. And we can dive into that a little bit later. But as far as Next Generation, the reasoning there, you know, several different uses of the word, I guess. Like, there's cutting edge, but then the other thing is that often when you're putting successful integrated pest management programs together, it's about the next generation of the crop. Because a lot of what you want to do is preventative, and you want to build systems that eliminate pest problems from happening. And then the other part of it was thinking about next generation in terms of, you know, the next generation of people trying to use organic practices, things that are going to produce medicine that is safe for people to use, and then it's also produced in a way that's safe for the workers.
So, okay, yeah. Excellent. It's funny, when I saw the name and learned more about it, I thought it was kind of like you were a Trekkie. You wanted to appropriate the name. So IPM, let's unpack that and explain it in a way for people who've never heard about it. What does it mean and why is it important when we talk about cannabis?
Okay, so IPM is Integrated Pest Management, and it's a philosophy of how to manage pests and diseases in agricultural crops that I would say the best way to think about it is that it's ecosystem-based, meaning that you look at the entire thing and you kind of evaluate both the host plant that you're dealing with, in this case cannabis, and then also the various pests and pathogens and how those things interact in an environment. Because when we say pest, really that's an artificial designation for an organism that in an artificial environment is getting way out of control and causing us problems. So if you can think about those organisms and the plant you're trying to protect and understand in what environments they thrive and in what environments they don't thrive, how they interact, their life cycles, you can start to deconstruct the process and approach pest management in a more complex way than just saying spray something and it'll go away. So you look at the environment you created in your facility, can you manipulate it and make it more beneficial for the plants, less so for the pests? You also look at ways to block them from coming into the situation in the first place. And then you look at the practices, we call it cultural practices, but the practices you use to grow your plant. So do you have things way packed together and you're creating an environment that is really beneficial for pests? You know, how are you watering things? How's your workflow? All of that. And then we also look at pesticides and biological controls. And biocontrols are things that are sort of natural predators of the insects and the mites and the pests you're dealing with that you can introduce into the environment and fight them with. And then in terms of pesticides, I'm a huge proponent of using organic pest control. If you're going to use pesticides, OMRI-listed products typically are going to be safer and are going to be better for consumers. So in general, that would be how I would kind of explain that and start.
Got it. That was really helpful. So it seems to me with your experience, you have been inside grows, and I'm assuming because of your expertise, you could see visually when there's a problem, or like take us to one kind of example. Obviously, we don't need the company name, but what would you see like with your knowledge of IPM? Like how would you know there's a problem? Like give us an example and what would you do to remedy it?
Okay, yeah. So oftentimes my first interaction with the client will be because they have a problem. So they'll call me in and the first step in trying to solve the issue is to diagnose it. So you want to look at what's going on with the plants, what are the signs and symptoms you're seeing, And what does that mean? And so a great example right now, kind of a hot pest control topic, is russet mites. They're very, very tiny mites that almost look kind of maggot-like, actually, if you get them under a microscope. But they're so tiny that they are pretty much impossible to see with the naked eye. So you need a microscope. Even with a 30x loop, you're not really able to see much detail. But you can see the signs that they cause on the plant. So in flower, you'll see death from the bottom of the plant upwards, often mistaken for a nutrient issue or something else. People don't really understand what's happening. In the vegetative cycle of growth, you'll tend to see the leaves kind of curling upwards, and also kind of a bronzing and a dying of the top tips of the plant. So you can go into the situation, kind of look at that, and then use a microscope or something else to actually diagnose the pest, and then start to go back and look at what has been done to control it, where it might have come from, start looking at the environment, and you know, just assessing the problem from there.
Now, would some of the infestations that you've dealt with, are they primarily a concern for owners because they could lose product, or are there also other concerns like workers' health because of the extensiveness of the infestations?
Yeah, so I would say a good example of a crossover there, because all of those different infestations are going to be an issue for the bottom line of the producer. And so there's often a lot of concern there. But when you get more into the fungal pathogens, particularly powdery mildew, which is very common in the industry, and then botrytis, which is known as bud rot in the industry, and that mold is very common in other agricultural situations. It's also the thing that if you leave strawberries out and you see that gray mold, just kind of take them over because they've been sitting on the shelf or on the counter too long. Same organism. It gets around and it's often present in the environment. If you give it a favorable environment, then you can have a problem. And I mentioned the fungal pathogens because those can be kind of a hazard to workers if there's a high volume of spores in the atmosphere. They're also going to, you know, limit the quality of your product, possibly reduce your harvest, especially in the case of botrytis. You can have that kind of have an outbreak in late bloom and lose portions of your crop. And then they can also taint your product if it's not caught and, you know, goes out to the public. So those would be the ones that are, you know, more of a worry in that way.
Okay. So when you mentioned PM, are we talking about grows that would call you for preventative measures, or the PM is so extensive they call you to come in and clean it up?
So oftentimes when I'm first coming in, and it very much depends on the situation, you know, because with next generation IPM, I try to be an ideal partner for cannabis businesses that are seeking to put plans in place. So maybe they're in the build out phase, or they're seeking to improve their plan, or they've got some sort of an emergency and we're working through it. But in the case of going in and starting to solve the problem, what we may do is look at short-term measures that we can take to knock the problem back, and then we look at things that we can do to really reduce the ongoing issue. And for powdery mildew, one thing that I would throw out there that's not a pesticide or anything like that is, you know, does your room have the ability to eject air out of the room at some point? Because a lot of grows will have a completely sealed environment because they're injecting CO2. And the thought process behind that is that plants consume CO2, they give off oxygen. So if you're injecting the CO2, the thought is that you don't need to refresh the air because you're just putting CO2 in there. But with a powdery mildew-like organism, a fungus, botrytis, something like that, they put spores out into the atmosphere. So if you're not exchanging air and moving it out of the room, then you can have sort of a rolling spore count that just builds up over time and will continue to get worse in that environment. And then we also look at the humidity level and other practices that you can do. But, you know, it's interesting with fungal pathogens, you can get a lot further with manipulating the environment and the infrastructure than you can with pesticides sometimes. It can be almost impossible to spray your way out of it.
Wow. No, this is fascinating because, again, I am drawn to, you know, workers' issues, occupational health and safety, and I also want employers to be having the right environment where you have minimal, you know, PM.
Yeah.
So let's say I come to you and I'm ready to design a grow. Mm-hmm. So what would be some of the, like, two or three things you recommend to create the right environment to have minimal PM and other pests?
Yeah, so, you know, kind of focusing on PM, going back to that ventilation system, separate from your HVAC and cooling, having something that can actually eject the air out of the room, and then having it set up so that air that's being pulled back in comes in through a passive HEPA filtration. So that's a type of filter that is very, very small and will block all pests and pathogens from coming back in. But in terms of worker safety and compliance there, that ventilation system is a really good crossover, because worker protection standard is a group of regulations that kind of governs how pesticides are used in agricultural industry. And sort of cutting to the chase, certain pesticides and certain spray equipment require that you're able to have a system that's ejecting air out of the room as things are applied and afterwards. So from a compliance standpoint, and then also as a tool in preventing things from becoming an issue, having that system in place is really important. And for powdery mildew, I would recommend running it at least periodically in the dark cycle of the plants if you're injecting CO2. That way you're not wasting your CO2. Another thing is looking at your dehumidification in the room and how that's spec'd out, so that in bloom you're not getting above, if you know you have a PM issue, around 40%. In vegetative growth, it can be advantageous to have a little bit higher humidity for the plants, but if you need to, dropping that humidity level. Another thing would be looking at what type of irrigation practices you're going to be using and when that irrigation is going to occur. Because if you have an irrigation system that creates standing water, even within the benching or on the canopy, and you're watering, say, going into the dark cycle, or you're watering at a frequency that causes a lot of pooling, you can have little pockets of humidity within the canopy that are created, and that's going to cause you PM issues as well.
Wow.
Plant spacing would be another thing to look at.
So a lot of moving parts with this.
Yeah, no, there's a lot of moving parts, but all of it kind of hinges on going back to what's the biology of the organisms, what's the biology of the plants, and the best resource I can recommend for learning more about that is look at University Extension and look at traditional agriculture, because they deal with a lot of the same pests and pathogens. And even though cannabis is a bit different, if you can go to those fact sheets and that extension information and look at that, it at least gives you kind of a basis that's going to be better than just going forum hunting.
Right. So, you know, I'm from the Bay Area in San Francisco. When I go home, my family members, you know, ask me, why don't they just grow outside? So my question is, would some of these problems, PM and other pests, be minimal to non-existent if we grew outside, or is that not a factor?
So that is one of those things where it's, you know, like many things, it depends, and it depends because, you know, where are you growing outside? Is it an environment like Colorado where we have pretty low humidity most of the time? Or if you go up to certain areas in, like, say, the Pacific Northwest or out on the West Coast, you might have areas that are really, really humid and moist, tons of moisture. And so that, in terms of your mold issues and your pest issues, that's going to influence it quite a bit, that environment. But I would say here in Colorado in specific, you can get away from some issues when you're growing outdoors, but then you run into some other things. One of the things at the cannabis research conference we went to that I found very interesting was down in Pueblo, they're very concerned about the interaction between hemp and cannabis and the outdoor grows. And the reason being is that in cannabis, kind of medical production, high THC cannabis production, or even oil production with hemp-type cannabis, what you're trying to do is create a whole big crop of female plants that don't get pollinated. Whereas if you're doing fiber hemp or seed hemp, some sort of more traditional hemp growth, you do a big mixed plot of males and females and lots of pollen gets flying. And so if you're outdoor and you don't have any sort of control to filter that out, you can have pollen coming in from other sources maybe pollinates and ruins your entire crop. And at that conference, there was a professor that had looked at the drift and viability of pollen. And in a nutshell, his take home was that it's not going to be viable for outdoor cannabis production of high THC female only and traditional hemp production to coexist in Pueblo. And his take was that the high THC or high oil producing cannabis guys that want to go female only should do greenhouses with air filtration systems.
Oh, so that could be a protector, but make sure the pollen doesn't carry over. So
yeah.
Why don't we take a little break, and then we're going to come back and talk a bit about some of your background and kind of the direction that you're going.
Okay, that'd be great.
So stay tuned, we'll be right back. Thank you. Hi, welcome back. I'm Marty Otañez, the host and producer of Getting High on Anthropology. Tonight's guest is Dan Banks with Next Generation. So Dan, when we talk about the work that you do, what kind of training or education did you receive that you're drawing upon to do the work that you do?
Sure. So my educational background is from Colorado State University. I graduated with a degree in horticultural science, and then I also minored in entomology, which is the study of insects. And I went back to CSU after kind of taking a break from college, bit after high school, knowing that I wanted to kind of get into cannabis. And so I went and studied horticulture because, you know, I wanted to have a more robust understanding of the science that underlays plant production. And I've always been very passionate about entomology, not just in terms of crop protection, but just in general. And so kind of went back to school with that lens and then completed my degree. And after graduating, went into the industry, and I've worked as a cultivation manager, also as an administrator, and then decided to form Next Generation IPM last August and kind of go out and consult on my own, because it's an amazing opportunity to work on a variety of different projects, get to have a wider breadth of experience. But in terms of the background, I think kind of marrying the practical experience of cannabis production with the more traditional horticultural background.
So one thing I love about people who are doing work like what you're doing is, you know, trying to find the story of that one moment when they realize I'm going to cross the line and make cannabis my thing. So was there one sort of aha moment where you said, like, was it in college? Was it when you got out? Like, what was that one moment you're like, okay, I'm going to do this?
So I think for me, that came back in kind of 2009 into 2010. I was at a point where, and I've always been kind of a cannabis enthusiast, going back to a little bit before graduating high school. I kind of discovered the plant in my junior year. I graduated in 2004. And so I sort of had it in the back of my mind that, you know, I really love this, and found myself in Colorado. The medical industry was just kind of starting to get rooted and established. And so I went back to school thinking that I might want to do that. But then also, once I got into school and kind of academia, there were different career paths. But when we had the vote on recreational and things were kind of ramping up into that, it was also around the time that I was going to be graduating. And I realized, like, you know, 100%, I want to jump into this. I don't want to go on to graduate school. I'd like to be a part of this industry. And at that time, it was still at this point where you know, some family members were kind of like, cannabis is great and all, but are you sure you want to do something that is federally illegal? Are you sure that you want to jump into a really unknown industry? And, you know, my thought at the time was like, hell yeah, this is great. I mean, this is an amazing ride. We're going to be able to do something awesome. And I'm really glad that it's worked out. And I've also, in the back of the mind, it's like, well, if the industry, for some reason, if it doesn't work out, there's other opportunities out there. But very happy that things have proceeded as they have, and I'm hopeful that we continue to see federal prohibition kind of roll back state by state and eventually go away. But we'll, you know, obviously things are still federally legal in each state, but you know what I mean, yeah. Legalization.
Well, that's great. I'm glad that you brought your family in, because I understand with the work we do and being associated with cannabis, it brings up all kinds of things. You know, people either sort of poo-poo it, or they just, you know, kind of laugh and, you know, have some kind of stereotype that they put onto you. So when you've had a discussion either with a family member or a friend who sort of kind of laughed at what you do with cannabis, what kind of stereotypes do you try to promote when you think about the work that you do and how people perceive you?
Yeah, you know, I've been fortunate to have most of my family be pretty accepting, and there were some people that were a little bit more on the, well, when are you going to go get a real job kind of side of things. But for the most part, they've been pretty supportive. And I think that in general, working in this industry, the onus is kind of on us to be ambassadors for it and to help people understand that it's serious business, it's serious agriculture. In many ways, it's just like other jobs, but also to help kind of normalize the use of the plant and the acceptance. And so I guess my thought there is more of being kind of an ambassador and making sure that the actions that you're taking and how you're presenting the industry and yourself is kind of consistent with being serious, but you know, also a little bit lighthearted about things sometimes.
So what's your vision like in the next 12 months? So with Next Generation, like in May 2018, where do you think you might be, or what's one or two kind of hurdles or goals you want to have met?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So I think that for me, one thing that's interesting is that I'm very good at what I do and the science side of things, but I kind of took this approach with starting the business of just kind of jumping in and figuring it out. So it's been a huge learning curve, and there's been tons of lessons learned, and it's been an amazing opportunity to better understand how a business is run. And so really, I think that my biggest goal is to kind of balance building a business and building a steady income stream, but then also really being genuine in the work that I do and building the relationships and enjoying the projects that I work on. And so, you know, I think that right now for me, that's really the goal, is to kind of toe that line between those two things.
Excellent. And so with the work that you do, social media and having a website is really important. So tell us your website, and when people visit it, what will they find on it? Because the work you do is highly visual, and there's some imagery on there. You have some russet mites and other kinds of things. So your website and the kinds of things people can find when they visit your website.
Yeah, so my website is nextgenerationipm.com. And there's also a link on there to my LinkedIn profile. You can check me out on there as well. The website is designed to give kind of a brief overview of what I do, the philosophy of the company, what integrated pest management is, and then there are also some resources for pest ID. I've got a lot more photos and things that I want to get uploaded. So in terms of business goals, I think that's one thing to kind of touch on too, is getting that further built out and getting a bigger presence out there on the internet. I've been fortunate to have a pretty robust network of professional network here in the Denver area. And so a lot of what I've been doing has been kind of word of mouth and has been working with kind of existing connections and building connections through local networking. And so I think kind of continuing to build things out and get a presence beyond Denver is something that I'm kind of working on there too. So we'll see more content posted up on the website as time goes on. But yeah.
Cool. And then there's got to be people that watch these kinds of shows that think, I want your job, or job likers.
Yeah.
So talk to the audience where you give them one or two things to consider that if they wanted to go down the trajectory that you took to have that kind of job, doing in the IPM work and working in the industry. So any recommendations or suggestions you have for people?
Yeah. I mean, I guess one of the suggestions that I've got is if you're in a position where you're at the point in your life where you're going to school, definitely focus on something that's going to help build you towards that career path. So in my case, entomology and horticulture is a huge significant focus. Another thing that for people that are in the industry that maybe want to take it more in the scientific direction or get an education and kind of move up, if you're up north, Fort Collins is an amazing place, and CSU has an awesome horticulture program and is a great school. I've had a lot of people say, hey, but I can't pause for my job, I can't take the time out to do this, and I can't commute up there. And kind of looking around at programs that are out there, OSU, Oregon State University, has a really good online horticulture program. And you could look at taking some modules just to build kind of your repertoire and your knowledge, or completing a degree online while also working. And I mentioned them because in looking around at all the different universities, their online program was one of the better ones that I've seen. So I definitely recommend checking that out. But also looking at just resources online to build your knowledge. Whitney Cranshaw is an entomologist who's very active here in Colorado. And he can't do anything on cannabis directly through the university, but he's put some things out there online just as a private citizen that are great resources for learning more about different pests and different diseases. He also has, in more of his university capacity, tons of more traditional information on pest control and entomology. So I think he's a really good resource to kind of start with as well.
Great. So the last question, you know, as a founder of Next Generation, an entrepreneur, an ambassador of cannabis, could you tell me, like, what's kind of one thing you worry about? Like when you go to sleep, like right now with the work you're doing, is there anything that kind of gives you stress or like you're concerned about? And then how do you imagine you kind of can address that or move beyond it?
Yeah, you know, I think that one of the issues that I see in the industry is that there's a lot of compartmentalization and, you know, a lack of kind of camaraderie between companies, between different markets, because everybody really wants to kind of ratchet down and say, this is mine and kind of hold it. And I want to try to be an ambassador for sharing information, for building bridges, because if you look at more traditional agriculture, you've got university extension you can go to, you have big trade organizations where people collaborate and come together and share information, and those industries are still doing very well. So I guess one of the things that I would say is you know, just seek to communicate and share information and build those bridges. And then in terms of something that I encounter that kind of keeps me up at night a little bit more, just some of the things you see with worker safety sometimes. And so I really like being an ambassador for proper pesticide usage and proper compliance and helping people understand the regulations, how to meet them, and how to keep people safe. One of the areas where we've got kind of a hole is in the use of 25B pesticides. And those are those that are exempt from federal regulations, so they're exempt from WPS compliance standards. And they often don't really have much in the way of suggestions or standards on protective equipment that have to be used with them. And so it's more up to the producer as to what to do. They're also kind of hawked as being very safe. And so you'll often see people just being like, oh, okay, well, I mean, it's just rosemary oil, so why can't I just spray that all over myself? And I guess my input there is, at the very least, wear gloves, wear eye protection, long sleeve, pants, if not a coverall, and then look at respiratory protection options as well, because we're a little bit off the grid compared to other agricultural industries in that we're in these enclosed environments often that are warehouses and things like that. And so you can have a little bit more exposure than you might have if you're in your garden outdoors applying pesticides. So, you know, just thinking about those things.
Yeah, too. No, great way to end. So what I want to do is thank you for taking the time. I learned a ton, and I'm sure some of the viewers got something out of this. And you want one more time to give people the website?
Yeah, so it's nextgenerationipm.com. And yeah, great being here with you.
Excellent. So thanks for tuning in, everybody. This, again, is Getting High on Anthropology. I'm Marty Otañez, the producer and host of the show, and we'll see you next time.